Download coming to you live from Church Militant Studios in Detroit. Michael's out for the day. As a quick update, Michael's father, Russ, is doing much better today, and we hope he'll be discharged from the hospital tomorrow. Thank you for your prayers. With us is Rodney Pelletier, taking time out of his busy schedule, producing our premium show, Mic'd Up, set to roll out next month. We're all looking forward to that. All this week, we are presenting the download for free to give those of you who are not yet premium subscribers the chance to sample the show for a week to encourage you to sign up. It's just $10 a month. That's just 33 cents a day. And for those of you who are premium subscribers, please feel free to offer whatever comments you want to encourage fellow viewers to sign up. Today, we're discussing the religious screening or grilling of Democrats of Trump's nominations during Senate judicial confirmation hearings. You may recall back in June, Senator Bernie Sanders upbraiding Trump's nominee, Russell Vought, for his Christian beliefs, saying they made Vought unfit for public office. Well, it's happened again. Last week, Senator Dianne Feinstein took to task Notre Dame law professor Amy Barrett, nominated by President Trump for federal court. So today, Christine will fill us in on the details of that lamentable judicial hearing. Rodney will flesh out what separates authentic Catholics from mere posers. And Simon will highlight a premium show that zeroes in on authentic Catholic identity. So, Christine, what went on between Senator Feinstein and Professor Amy Barrett?
Yeah, as a quick recap, Professor Amy Barrett is a Notre Dame law professor, and she's pro-life. She's a Catholic mother of seven, devout, very obviously just a faithful Catholic, and she makes that clear in her writings. Well, she's been nominated by Trump for the Federal Court of Appeals, so she had to endure some grilling during the Senate judicial confirmation hearings. But what we saw was sheer anti-Catholic bigotry on display. We have a clip here of Democrat Senator Dianne Feinstein with her now famous phrase about the dogma living loudly within. So let's go ahead and run that clip now.
When you read your speeches, the conclusion one draws is that the dogma lives loudly within you. And that's of concern when you come to big issues that large numbers of people have fought for years in this country.
Now, these big issues that she's referring to are abortion, contraception, and gay marriage. And it's become a bit of a meme now. The dogma lives loudly within you, and a lot of Catholics are just kind of wearing that on their sleeve because it should live loudly within us. That's the right thing to do as Catholics. Now, people were upset by the anti-Catholic bigotry on display, so that such that even Father John Jenkins, who's president of Notre Dame, wrote a letter to Senator Feinstein. He's not exactly an Orthodox Catholic, but he was upset because nobody likes to see this sort of, you know, attacking of the Catholic faith, especially in the Senate, where you're supposed to respect, you know, people's religious freedom and their beliefs. He wrote a letter and concluded the letter here. Here's a quote from the letter saying, "It is chilling to hear from a United States senator that this might now disqualify someone from service as a federal judge. I ask you and your colleagues to respect those in whom dogma lives loudly, which is a condition we call faith." That was Father Jenkins, president of Notre Dame. Another senator who also kind of attacked Professor Barrett's faith was Senator Dick Durbin, another Democrat. And what he objected to was she had written an article a while back distinguishing between Orthodox Catholics and other kinds of Catholics, all right? And basically meaning Orthodox Catholics are those who stick to the teachings of the Catholic Church. And he objected to this. Senator Durbin objected to this. He basically said that this unjustly maligns other kinds of Catholics who dissent on teachings on abortion and homosexuality and contraception. He didn't want to make those distinctions, which is kind of ridiculous. But yeah, it was just total anti-Catholic bigotry on display in the Senate, and I don't think it's going to stop anytime soon.
Well, you know, there's no litmus test for religion, but there should be a litmus test for reason, sanity within before you can be elected. And when Dick Durbin says, you know, you can't distinguish between Orthodox Catholic and non-Orthodox, well, absolutely you can. It's mutually exclusive. If you say, I'm not an Orthodox Catholic, well, you're not Catholic, period. Well, there's other people besides Dick Durbin saying this. Father James Martin is actually saying our Lord would not distinguish or separate people on in areas of doctrine.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think both Dick Durbin and Father Martin, the famous or infamous Jesuit priest, both disagree with our Lord. Our Lord disagrees with them. Father Martin is very fond of saying fluffy and saccharine things like, for Jesus,
and there heretical is... things.
And, yeah, well, besides heretical, just fluffy and saccharine. We'll stick with that for now. Saying, for Jesus, there is no us and them, only us.
He claims that's the central tenet of his book, Building a Bridge.
Wow.
That's the central tenet.
No, right. that's so wrong.
There is no bridge neither.
There's no bridge. There's all
the road.
So, you want to have a lot of fun, go look at Father Martin's Twitter feed. He's saying stuff all the time. Sometimes he's all right, but most of the time, not so much. But there's a couple spots in the Gospels, especially where our Lord specifically disagrees with this whole there is no other theory. In one spot in the Gospel of Matthew, our Lord says, do not think that I have come to bring peace on earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. So there's that one. That's pretty...
so divisive.
Pretty straight to the point.
Our Lord was divisive.
He was absolutely divisive. Well, here's another one. He who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. He who finds his life will lose it, and he who loses his life for my sake will find it. That's another, othering of people. So in other places, our Lord, he spoke of the separation of the sheep and the goats. And even more finally, he said, in the part of the Gospel of Matthew, where he says, when you don't do this to the least of my brethren, you haven't done it to me. He says, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire, which was prepared for the devil and his angels. To me, that's one of the most terrifying things you can hear.
Yeah. That scripture verse about, if you don't take your cross and follow me, that's the problem with Father Martin, because he's basically not telling active gays to pick up their cross, which is that of chastity, and follow Christ. If anything, he's saying your cross is the Catholic Church because they're so mean and they refuse to understand you and embrace you as you are.
Right. And then now with the coming, the 500th anniversary of the Protestant deformation, next month in October, you have all these priests and bishops having, Reformation celebrations and stuff like that, celebrating, I don't know what, the heresy, the confusion of Christians for 500 years now. We need more other. We've heard, so little of it. We hear all this unity, 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 but it's not really unity because our Lord came, as it says, he came to divide, to bring a sword, truth and untruth.
Yeah.
So. Well, he came to divide. It'll be two against three and three against two. A man's house will be divided.
Father against his son, mother against
his daughter.
Of
the result that some will accept the truth and some won't. The other cute thing I thought about Father Martin, when he was taken to task for some of his silliness, he starts throwing out the Donatists. He's like, you're heretics and you're heretic. That was all kind
He's very quick to other people who disagree with
him. There was a tweet that he put out objecting to Trump's rescinding of the Dreamers program and saying, well, everyone you exclude, he's talking about immigrants, everyone you exclude is other. Everyone you exclude is Jesus. And then someone tweeted, is everyone you block Jesus? Because he's notorious for blocking anyone who disagrees with him.
Mutes them on Twitter. Well, with all of this Catholic distinctions or non-distinctions being bandied about, what show do you have that actually focuses in on authentic Catholic identity?
We got a ton of shows that do that, Brad.
All
of our shows do that. But let's kind of discuss specifically this issue of Catholic identity and distinctions being drawn. It's a very, very important thing. Rodney's touched on it. That you need to draw distinctions between one thing and another. If if we take it to its logical conclusion, you reduce it to absurdity, if there are no distinctions, it's just a big homogenous soup, and there's literally,
well,
you know,
relativism.
And there's no distinction between anything. These distinctions are very important, but one of the most important distinctions is, as you say, this notion of Catholic identity, and one of the ways that that's achieved is by using authentic Catholic vocabulary. You use Catholic words for Catholic concepts rather than using maybe a kind of watered-down Protestant word to maybe refer to what ultimately becomes a watered-down Protestant concept within Catholicism. If you lose your Catholic identity, you've lost your Catholicism, and as we know, Catholicism is the only form of salvation there is. So we've got a bit of a clip here from one of the premium shows. Let's take a look at it.
The number one thing catechetic, and I think this is where the heart of the problem is, they stopped the systematic teaching of the faith, especially memorization, memorizing the creed and explaining it, memorizing Our Father and explaining, learning how to say the rosary and explaining, answering what is the Eucharist, what is the Mass, that sort of thing.
That's caused, I mean, it's the damage that's been caused from that just can't be calculated.
Right, and like Father Trujillo, I believe, said at EWTN, bad catechesis, bad morality, bad doctrine, bad liturgy. It just, just like in a row.
Yeah, so it's just one big rotten stew.
Yeah, so that's a very important point there that they make in the show. That's our Losing My Religion show, and that particular episode is called Catholic Vocabulary, but there's a load of shows, load of episodes in that show that discuss this issue of losing your religion through this loss of Catholic identity and a failure to make distinctions. All of our programming is designed to make these distinctions, because what it does is it defines, it puts an edge on things, and it says, well, this is where this thing is, and this is where that thing is, and this is Catholicism, and this is not. This is truth, and this is not. This is God, and this is man. This is sacred, and this is profane. So these are very important distinctions that the liberals want to blend over in many cases. We see it with things such as Extraordinary Ministers of Holy Communion, blurring the line between the priesthood and the laity. We see it with the removal of the altar rail, blurring the line between the sacred sanctuary and the less sacred body of the church. You can constantly go along. That's just in the liturgy, but you can see it everywhere. The blurring of the distinction between married and unmarried, between heterosexual and homosexual, between acceptable sexual behavior and not, between men and women, and go on. Our programming will help you define these things and will arm you to do that. And really, yeah, you need, for the sake of $10 a month, to get out there and get you some of that.
Well, yeah, as you pray, as Father said on the show, Guardiolas, as you pray, so you believe. And as you believe, you're putting into practice, so you live. Mm-hmm. But getting back with Professor Amy Barrett here, what Feinstein is actually insinuating is that because you believe in the sanctity of human life, that is going to blur all of your legal decisions, which is completely untrue. When it's just a profane example, when the MMA is coming to, or the UFC, I should say, is coming to Detroit, because you know martial arts, or you know boxing, or you know jiu-jitsu or something else, doesn't mean that you're going to use, if you're limited in what tools you're going to use, then you can use those. And Amy Barrett knows law. She's going to be applying law to the cases. I may believe from faith that killing someone is wrong. The Constitution says I can't take away the rights of someone else, and that is the tool by which you adjudicate.
Yeah. Now, going back to the failure to make distinctions and this loss of Catholic identity, things were different before Vatican II. I mean, the Church had more of an us against them mentality. It was very, much more rooted in who we are. But then, of course, Vatican II with Aggiornamento. Good intentions, trying to open up the church to the world and bring the church out into the world, but unfortunately we let too much of the world into the church. And then back then in the early part of the century, we were fighting a lot of open anti-Catholic bigotry. So we very much had this idea of us versus them. The Ku Klux Klan was very powerful. Their anti-Catholic bigotry was all over the place. And then of course, that fell more and more to the wayside in the past 50 years so that we became more accepted. But the problem is, now we're like anybody else, really. Catholics, they are like anybody else in society.
What you're saying there with us and them mentality, you take that one step further. From Vatican II on forward, there was the failure to make distinctions, mm-hmm. starting with Vatican II, the ambiguities, the equivocations. And in our present pontificate, you can even ask the question and still not get an answer on clarifications. Mm-hmm. That lack of clarity comes out with Dick Durbin mm-hmm. and saying, well, I say Catholic means that yeah. I can do whatever I want. And when Amy Barrett was saying, well, Catholic means that you're going to accept what Catholic teaching is, that's authentic use of the term Catholic.
Yeah.
It's a very reasonable thing.
Right. These, you know, Reformation celebrations that Catholic parishes are having all over the place. One of the stories we're reporting on today involves a parish in Lansing, Michigan, that is offering a Reformation ecumenism service. And a concerned parishioner wrote to the priest there, Father Ganey, who's been a priest for 50 years, and said, okay, fine, but are you going to make clear during the service that Lutherans, you know, come to the fullness of the truth in the Catholic faith? Are you going to make any sort of moves to encourage them to convert? And the priest wrote back this long note saying, basically, no. Basically saying, well, Vatican II says this, and he was misquoting Vatican II, basically saying, there are brothers in Christ, you know, and they're good where they are, and we need to focus on unity, and so basically, no, I'm not going to say anything about
that. Well, that's the problem with Amoris Laetitia. That's the problem with Father Martin. Are we extending the invitation to accept the full teachings of the Church? Are we extending to the... To people who are struggling with same-sex attraction, like other people struggle with all sorts of things, well, we want to help you with truth and grace to overcome that.
No, because that's judgmental.
Exactly.
But you have to accept them.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, unconditionally. That's the whole point. You know, when Durbin comes along and says, I find your use of the phrase Orthodox Catholic offensive,
right.
because what it does is that is suggesting that there are Catholics who you say are not Orthodox, are heretical, unorthodox, what have you, and then not real Catholics. Well, let's flip this round, Senator. By you saying of Barrett, I think you're wrong, you're challenging her Catholicism. Her mm-hmm. Catholicism, which says, you know, this is exclusive. It's the classic philosophical conundrum. You say, you know, it's, to quote the great philosopher and swords fighter Obi-Wan Kenobi, only a Sith deals in absolutes, making an absolutist statement. The moment that you say there is absolutely no absolute truth, then you've made an absolute truth. And that's the whole point. And that's what people like Dick Durbin are doing. They're saying, you know, well, I do not accept your universalism, and I reject your universalism. Okay, so you've rejected that, which is a violation of universalism. And it's absolute truth is fundamentally provable just on its simple basis.
The skeptic says, I know for certain that I can't know anything for certain.
Yeah.
That's a definition of a skeptic,
yeah.
which is kind
it's
of an oxymoron.
Logically. Yeah. But, you know, Father Martin, I know he puts himself out there as this merciful, kind, compassionate person who just wants to build a bridge. And so a lot of people see him that way. The guy is poison. I mean, we just reported on him at Fordham University coming out and saying, there for the whole world, I spoke to my friend such and such and his husband, and I just don't see how the most traditionalist, homophobic person could not see this as an act of love, and he said, reverence it. That's his word. Mm-hmm. So he's basically saying Catholics should reverence gay marriage, which involves gay sex, which is intrinsically evil. This is what the man is pushing.
Yeah, well, the clarity we're about here is clarity is actually your charity. To tell them where they're at, where, you know, if they're over the ship, you throw them a life preserver because that's where they're at. You pull them on board. So we need clarity out there, and that's our former chair. We're out of time, but do take the time to learn your faith for your sake, the sake of your loved ones. We do this every weekday, live at 10:30 a.m. Eastern Time, and, of course, on playback for the rest of the day for your viewing. The download is built around the idea that there are many things going on in the world that are of interest to or impact Catholics. The panel here pulls out an authentically Catholic microscope and closely examines these various things culturally, politically, theologically, to help you understand their relevance to the Church. We're making the download free all week so you can get an idea of our premium programming. If you haven't signed up yet and you'd like and want to support our programming and help us keep doing what we're doing, please consider signing up for just $10 a month. We're a nonprofit that relies on your help to stay afloat. Help us continue putting out quality Catholic content you won't find anywhere else in the media world by signing up for a premium subscription. Thanks for joining us. Please come back tomorrow for the type of discussion that ought to be occurring every day in the Catholic media world. God bless.